Hello and welcome to Med Tutorials. This is your place for simple and easy to follow tutorials in internal medicine. This is going to be level 4 in the series titled Decoding the ECG. If you're new to ECGs, I recommend that you see levels 1 to 3 before you come to this level. I'll be putting the link in the description box below. Today is going to be all about calculating the axis of the heart. At the end of this tutorial, you should be able to understand what we mean by cardiac axis, what is the normal axis of the heart, what is left axis deviation, and what is right axis deviation, how we can accurately calculate the axis of the heart. And finally, I will show you a quick method in an ECG how we can calculate the axis. And we're going to be doing this in examples of ECGs so that you can gain some confidence by the end of this tutorial. So let's get started. So what exactly is the axis? It is the mean direction in which the QRS complex is pointing to in the frontal plane of the body. It is an indication of the overall direction of the electrical activity of the heart. Since it's in the frontal or vertical plane, we need to look at only the limb leads to determine the axis of the heart. What is the normal axis of the heart? If the axis lies anywhere between minus 30 degrees and plus 90 degrees, it is considered to be normal axis. If the axis lies between minus 30 degrees and minus 90 degrees, it is considered to be left axis deviation. If the axis lies between plus 90 degrees and plus 180 degrees, it is considered to be right axis deviation. Finally, if the axis lies between plus 180 degrees and minus 90 degrees, it is considered to be extreme axis deviation, or sometimes called indeterminate axis. So why do we need to determine the axis of the heart? The axis of the heart in itself is not diagnostic of any particular condition, but it may give you a clue to the underlying condition. So you always need to correlate the heart axis with the other findings in the ECG and also clinically. Now, if the ECG shows a left axis deviation, it may be normal or it may be a clue to the left ventricular hypertrophy or left bundle branch block, left anterior fascicular block, or an inferior MI or a ventricular pacing. If the ECG shows a right axis deviation, again, it may be normal, but it could also be a pointer to right ventricular hypertrophy or a left posterior fascicular block or COPD or a lateral STEMI. Occasionally, you may get an extreme axis deviation, and this may be seen in severe right ventricular hypertrophy, sometimes in hyperkalemia or ventricular tachycardia. We will now look into the rules we need to apply to determine the axis of the heart. First, the mean QRS will be in the direction of the lead that shows the tallest R wave. So we need to look for the lead having the QRS complex with the tallest R wave. Second, if two leads have equally tall R waves, the mean QRS will be midway between them. So if you find two leads in a tie for having the tallest R waves, the mean axis is midway between the leads. Third, the axis will be perpendicular to the lead having an equiphasic QRS complex. So if you have a lead with QRS complex that has an R and an S of equal amplitude, the mean QRS axis will be perpendicular to that lead. The fourth rule is the mean QRS complex is usually opposite in direction to the complex that shows the deepest S wave. Now, using the rules you have just learned and the figure on your right, let us try to determine the axis in the following ECG. You may pause the video and try it for yourself. Step 1. Which is the lead with the tallest R wave? We see lead 1 and lead 2 have almost equally tall R waves. The rule 2 says that the mean QRS axis should lie in between the two leads that have equally tall R waves. Now, looking at the diagram on the right, we see that lead 1 at 0 degrees and we see lead 2 at plus 60 degrees. The axis most likely to be in between the two, and that's around plus 30 degrees. Step 2. Are there any equiphasic waves? We do not see any equiphasic waves in this ECG. Step 3. Which lead has the deepest S wave? You will notice that AVR has the deepest S wave. Thus, the axis has to be in the opposite direction. That correlates perfectly with what we derived from the first rule, that the axis has to be between lead 1 and 2. Works out to be plus 30 degrees, which is in the range of a normal axis. So hopefully you're a little more confident now and you can try determining the axis of the heart on the second ECG. So pause and try it out. Step 1, which is the tallest R wave? We see that AVL has the tallest R, with lead 1 coming a close second. Rule says that the mean QRS axis will be in the direction of the tallest R wave, that makes the axis close to minus 30 degrees. Step 2. Are there any equiphasic QRS waves? Observe that the QRS is equiphasic in lead AVR. That means the axis is perpendicular to AVR. Now look at the diagram. Perpendicular to AVR can mean an angle of either plus 120 or an angle of minus 60 degrees. So which one is it? From the first step, we have already seen that the axis was in the direction of AVL, that is minus 30 degrees. So it is more likely that the axis is minus 60 degrees and not plus 120 degrees, which is in the opposite direction. Step 3. Which lead has the deepest S wave? Lead 3 shows the deepest S wave. The rule says that the mean QRS will be in the opposite direction. Again, opposite to plus 120 degrees is minus 60 degrees. So from step 2 and 3, the most accurate estimation is the heart's axis is around minus 60 degrees. That falls in the area of left axis deviation. We're going to try it out one more time, so go ahead, pause the video and try to determine the axis. Step 1. Which lead has the tallest R wave? Lead 3 has the tallest R wave, so the direction looks like it's around plus 120 degrees. Step 2. Which lead has an equiphasic QRS complex? Lead AVR is equiphasic, so the axis has to be perpendicular to the direction of AVR. Now we have two directions that can be perpendicular to AVR. But from step 1, we have a general idea that the direction is plus 120 degrees. So it's unlikely to be in the opposite direction. From these two steps, it is clear that the axis is plus 120 degrees, which is in the range of right axis deviation. Now in practice, when we look at the ECGs, we sometimes deploy a quick method to calculate the axis. It's not entirely foolproof and you may miss out on extreme or indeterminate axis at times, but it is really quick and easy to remember. What you need to do is look at the QRS complex in leads 1 and AVF. If the axis is normal, the QRS in both the leads will be predominantly positive, that is, they will be looking in the upward direction. If the QRS complex in these leads appear to be leaving each other, that is, in lead 1, the QRS is predominantly positive with a tall R wave, and lead AVF is predominantly negative with a deep S wave, it is indicative of left axis deviation. So it's very simple, leaving each other equals left axis deviation. On the other hand, if the QRS in lead 1 and AVF appear to be reaching each other, that is, lead 1 has a deep S wave and lead AVF has a tall R wave, then it is indicative of a right axis deviation.
So reaching each other equals right axis deviation. We are now going to try it out to find the axis in the following ECG using this quick method. So look at lead 1 and AVF and observe the QRS complex. Lead 1 is predominantly upward with a tall R wave, while AVF is downward with a deep S wave. Lead 1 and AVF, the QRS, appears to be leaving each other. Leaving each other equals left axis deviation. Now that you've got the hang of it, pause this video and try this second ECG for yourself using this quick method. Here one is downward with an S wave, while AVF is upward with a tall R wave. It appears as if they are reaching each other. Reaching each other equals right axis deviation. Try this ECG now. Pause and try it. Here both 1 and AVF are upward, neither leaving nor reaching. This is indicative of a normal axis. So summarizing, the mean QRS axis is determined in the frontal plane using the limb leads. Following the four rules, we can try to map out the axis and where it is pointing to. The quick method involves looking at leads 1 and AVF. Leaving each other equals left axis deviation. Reaching each other equals right axis deviation.
Well, I hope you're a little more confident now in assessing the axis of the heart. In the next tutorial, we're going to be putting all that we have learned so far together, and we're going to be looking into the steps that we have to carry out when we approach an ECG. So if you'd like to see more videos like this, please do subscribe and hit the notification bell. Till the next time, bye-bye.